name is Jasmine Duran and I am a junior, and I will be introducing Kaya Benrahi, along with my associate, Caitlin Goodfellow. Claudia Bernardi has had a long history of giving a voice to the voiceless. In the 1980s, the Argentine Forensic Anthropology Team was asked by the United Nations Truth Commission to investigate the massacre of El Mozote during the Salvadorian Civil War. In 2005, after growing a relationship with the people of El Mozote, Claudia opened the School of Art and Open Studio of Pepin El Santo. As one of their first projects, the school decided to paint a mural with the community for the 20th anniversary of the massacre, depicting life before the tragedy. Claudia, along with her fellow art instructors, has gone on to bring this art model to victims of war and abuse in Guatemala, Colombia, and countless other countries around the world. Then, in 2006, Claudia came to Mary Baldwin's campus as that year's Elizabeth Kirkpatrick Dodgins visiting artist. Instantly, Claudia captured the hearts of the Mary Baldwin community and became a sister squirrel. In 2007, Claudia helped a group of students transform a blank bakery wall in Stanton into a beautiful community point of pride. Later in 2008, Claudia was named Artist of Residence at Mary Baldwin College. The following year, Claudia decided to bring their project closer to home, transforming a large blank wall in front of the Spencer Center into a story of multiculturalism, empowerment, and peace. Claudia has continued to be an active member of the Mary Baldwin community, with her latest project engaging a community of a different kind. In 2014, after the spike of unaccompanied youth crossing the border into the United States, many of those youth came to the Shenandoah Valley. With the help of a group of Mary Baldwin students, Claudia was able to give these youth a voice and create art that told their stories. Claudia has inspired and educated the students of Mary Baldwin College to be activists of their own. It's our honor to introduce Claudia Bernardi.
Teach here officially. I am an artist in residence slash permanent friend, Mary Mullen. But I teach in California, I teach at the California College for the Arts, and Mary Bowen comes up very frequently in our conversations. Many, many of the projects that we have done here would have been harder to create in California, and I'm not very sure why that is, because I'm the same person and the university is very supportive, CCA is, but I think it may be that it's a much larger, you know, urban area, more difficult to establish connections. There's a greater opportunity here, I think, to go from idea to action. So I want to acknowledge that. Thank you, Pamela and Kate, for that. And thank you, everyone, for being here. Dear friends, I look around and say, I know all these people. That's so great. So, the presentation today has two parts. We are going to start where we left it last fall, which is in Argentina. So for the ones who may not remember what happened in Argentina, or if you were not here during that lecture, last year was my sabbatical year, and I spent it mostly in Argentina, with the exception of the two times I came to Mary Baldwin for main term and for the fall lecture. But what the projects I was able to help facilitate in Argentina were about was reaching the community of people who were connected to the disappeared. And this is a long story of the tragic story of Argentina. These are steals from a short documentary. So my proposal was to work with families of the disappeared who had been able to retrieve the human remains of their loved ones thanks to the work of the Argentine Forensic Anthropology team. When we talk about disappearances in Argentina, the number is very stretchable. Between 30,000, maybe more, maybe less, but 30,000 is the number that historically has been accepted. But there is a much smaller group of families of the disappeared who, thanks to DNA testing, have been able to retrieve the human remains of their loved ones. And this is a new episode in the history of Argentina. Started I think about 7-8 years ago when DNA testing was more possible. So that's part of the Argentine team's work today. One of the most remarkable parts of this project was that we worked to create a mural in the largest clandestine center of detention and extermination in the history of Argentina. To have a historical parallel, perhaps, it would be concurrent to the idea of what it would be like to create a mural in Auschwitz. In this place, at ESMA, over 5,000 people were taken in prison illegally. They were tortured, they were exterminated without a trial, and they were disposed of in different ways. Because of the location of ESMA, which is close to the river and close to the airport, the most recurrent form of disposing of the disappeared was to take them on the death flights. People were administered a very strong sedative, and when they were on the plane, still alive, they were thrown into the ocean. This was part of a macabre kind of project or proposal, but I would like to invite you to think that this was not an accident. That is part of state terror. It happened during 8 years, every Wednesday, from 379 clandestine centers of detention that were operating simultaneously in Argentina. A group between 30 and 50 people were extracted and disposed of in this fashion. ESMA, now called ex-ESMA, is the largest clandestine center of detention of Argentina. And last year, a group of 57 people painted a beautiful mural. Beautiful mural that is much longer than this one. I'm just showing the part that is probably the summary of it, in which the families are hugging the human remains of their loved ones. And next to the image of the family loving the human remains, there is a thumbprint that identifies presence. Here we are. This is our identity. And it is just behind a scale that talks about justice. Since 2009 until now, over 700 military men have been tried in Argentina and given very important convictions, some of which are life in prison. So Argentina is an interesting country to see the development of the tenacity of jurisprudence and trying to identify that this is not us against them. This is a government that is being acting as state terror, and what the citizens have in response is the demand of trial and punishment. When, according to the participants of this project, when we are able to have our beloved remains and the process of justice is conveyed, life starts again. It's not necessarily healing because other wounds open, but it is a moment of correctness. And that is what this mural is about. This was painted in March. And this is the full mural and the wonderful participants of this project. After this project, I came to Mary Baldwin. We did the wonderful community project with the train, the beast, remember, in the with incarcerated undocumented minors from Central America. And then I went back to Argentina. And when I went back to Argentina, the same participants of the mural and others, also connected to the families of the disappeared, were very unhappy with part of the building that was not painted. So they said, what are we going to do with this? For the ones who know Spanish, ¿qué vamos a hacer con esta pared blanca? What are we going to do with this white wall? It doesn't really match. So we decided to paint it. And the wonderful part of this project is that, like the previous one, we have mothers of the disappeared, we have siblings of the disappeared, partners, husbands and wives of the disappeared. We had sons and daughters of the disappeared. But we also had a lot of children. We had the grandchildren of the disappeared. So we were having this full circle of lineage connected to this very heavy place. But we were transforming it with the memories of the people who were painting it. And now a big challenge was, we have painted from here up to here, and now we are going back in history. How are we going to deal with that? Well, they knew everything. So remember how the mural ends with the tree of life. So from the other side, the mural begins with a tree of life that is very small. This is what you see at the left. And they are just planting the tree of life that later will grow. In the memory of the participants, they thought about the time when they were young, they were children, and how safe it was to be playing in the Central Plaza, being not accompanied by adults, until one of the adults said, you were not accompanied by adults because we, the adults, were watching you from our house. But we were all in accordance. We knew where you were. It was a safe time. So people talk about that as a period previous to the military junta. Then there was visually a big challenge, which is a real window. What do you do with a real window? And what you do with a real window is you build a table right in front. And I thought that was brilliant. It was great. They painted, you know, the scene of the mate with the cake, very inviting. And the blue chairs, there were two blue chairs without the shirt at first, until they finished it and looked at it from afar. And one of them said, "That chair feels very lonely. It really feels as if it is empty. Let me hang on it a coat or a shirt so it will be as if someone is about to come back." And yeah, we did that. And then the next part was talking about community work and process of literacy. You should know that in the time of the military junta, the literacy programs were considered subversive, and many people who were working in literacy projects in shanty towns are the ones who had disappeared. On the other hand, the unions were also a target of the military junta. Any kind of community work would be considered subversive. The people who painted this mural wanted to go back to the memory of how being a community leader or being thinking about education because you have it and some other people don't is not subversive. It's a gift of community. We in Argentina have to go back to reconsider all that happened before and after the military junta. We need to find new language to reincorporate the same praxis. It's a big challenge. So here it is, here's the whole mural. And the participants, including Rosita, age 3, who was very upset because she could not give all the directions. She only gave some, and we obey. "Because you all are my family, my dear, dear friends, I could not tell you about a wonderful moment of last year, which is that the Argentine Forensic Anthropology team, the 3 founder members of the Argentine Forensic team, Luis Fondebride, Mercedes Doretti, and my sister Patricia Landi, were awarded an honorary doctorate from the University of Buenos Aires." What a moment. I was fighting with the media because I was sitting in the first row and I was the one to go to photograph. And the media was upset. "What newspaper are you from? Just be quiet." And my sister. "But I have great photographs." And they were asking me to give the photographs for the media, which I did. So here they are. And this is for me a very, very beautiful, very touching photograph. Because over the 30 years of the Argentine Forensic team's life, so many times we wonder, why are we doing this? It's always hard, has been at certain times dangerous, needless to say, underfunded. Why are we doing that? And the people say, we are doing this for the families. The same families that in the mural had their human remains. And this is a moment in which many of the families, many of them very old now, have come to say thank you for what you do. It was beautiful. The first image on the top is Hugo Morresi, whose son was disappeared at age 17. And the Argentine forensic team found his human remains quite early in the life of the team. So he, Mr. Morresi, has been a true supporter of the team in so many ways. And here, a niece of ours, Anita and Patri and I. Those moments that, you know, may not be repeated in life, but here we are celebrating it. I'm so glad I can tell you about this evening. They continue the work. And almost a year ago, in October, I was invited by the Museum of Memory in La Plata. The province of Buenos Aires is very large. The Capital Federal is where most of the people in Buenos Aires live, but the state's capital is La Plata. And it is there where the mural of the mural, the Museum of Memory is located. And I was invited to work in a project of which I knew nothing, which is recent police brutality. Police brutality that is happening now while we talk. And this, to me, was a moment both of recognition, learning, and also awareness of how much one may not fully know. The mural presented also a challenge in that part was inside, and there was one part outside. Okay, no problem for muralists, we can always integrate, right? To work with this mostly group of women, although there was this gentleman, Santiago, was the only man. They are mothers and a father of people who have been killed by police brutality in recent months. I was not aware of that. One of the mothers had lost her son 5 weeks before. So the emotions were on the skin, together with the fear of painting a mural like everyone has, and also trying to figure out what is what we are going to say in this mural. It was also important to recognize that it was at the Museum of Memory. The Museum of Memory functions as a cultural gathering of information. It is a big, on-moving archive. They were interested in having this particular group to come and talk to us and to the public by and large, because police brutality is sort of taboo in Argentina. It's hard to open the newspaper and find out what is happening. So as the ones who have seen mural painting through these presentations know, we always start by having moments of drawing and selection of drawings, and then the people choose what to do and where to put it. They converse, and from this conversation, it expands what this mural is going to be about. The slogan, Ni un pibe menos, which in sort of slang from Buenos Aires means not one child less, is a slogan that the group of mothers that are connected through their activism against police brutality have coined. So you see in Buenos Aires now many painted walls that said exactly that, Ni un pibe menos, not a child less. Another part of this project, which for me was hugely moving and challenging to a certain extent, both for the physicality of it and how to deal with these memories, is that the siblings of the kids that had been killed were also part of the project. And I felt at one moment that perhaps it would have been a better idea to have one project with the children and one with the adults. That didn't happen for many reasons, but the adults said, the kids know perfectly well what is going on. I mean, we do not hide anything. So the children were very much part of the whole project. One of the acknowledgments of these murals is to the mothers of Plaza de Mayo, the mothers that have been searching for their sons and daughters that have disappeared. They wanted to honor them because although their quest, their activism is different because they do have the bodies of their sons and daughters, they have learned from the mothers and also from the grandmothers how to do activism, how to make these very difficult issues be known. So what else does the mural say? I love the image of Fernanda. Fernanda lost her son a year before this project. Fernanda is the woman who is at the extreme right, lower right. The story of Fernanda, which is the one I choose to talk about because summarizes all the rest, is that her son was found close to the river, dead, and the police told her that they didn't know what it was, although an autopsy proved that the cause of death was a fracture of the cranium produced with a very contundent kind of heavy something. That is something that the police did not declare. But she wanted to know what happened, and she was not told. She connected to lawyers, and the lawyers, some helped, some didn't. But what Fernanda kept on saying is, I want to learn, I want to know, I want to understand what happened, even if the story is terrible. And I said to Fernanda, well, what is what you want? And she said, I want to hear what the earth remembers. I said, then try to do that. How would you hear what the earth remembers? So she did exactly that. She put her body in that position and tried to hear what actually happened. So she painted herself exactly in that position of learning from the earth. About 6 months after that, she actually did know what happened to her son, and she was also able to identify who is responsible. The challenging part outside are two beautiful flowers that are an invitation to come in. And these are the mothers and siblings of the children, the youth born and dying very shortly and terribly circumstances of violence. It's hard for us Argentines to recognize that. So much effort is being placed to know what happened with and to the disappeared. And now we have this new episode of police brutality, which sadly is happening in this country as well. What do we do with the legislation system that needs to be reconsidered? What do we do in Argentina or in the United States when the police may not be the one agency to get help from, but to be cautious with? What needs to happen, and how we citizens can activate the questions? We don't have the answers, but like these women, we have the questions. Ex-ESMA went from being a place of memory to being a place of murals. So we painted a third mural in ESMA, and this time the participants were people who work at ESMA, people who work for the different agencies, mothers of Casa de Mayo, sons and daughters, well, everything that you have there. Interesting part of this project is that they are all in agreement, right? They all work at ex-ESMA. They have a lot in common. They all work for human rights agencies, and they would not be able to get anything in common. It was one of the most difficult projects I have ever facilitated. What was I thinking, right? I'm in Argentina with all these people that are trained to be very political. So consensus, was it possible? And the wall was huge. So this was 1 day, 2 days, the third day, we had only 4 days. At the end of the third day, I said, you know what? This mural is not gonna be finished. And it will be about how it wasn't finished because you didn't get along. Don't tell us that. What do you want me to tell you? Honey, I'm asking you, this route meets this route, and you give me a political jargon, and I only want to know if this route and this route will meet. I don't know anymore things about politics. Well, somehow that helped. A lot of people, wonderful people, don't take me wrong. But this is really interesting for the ones in this wonderful audience who has worked with mural projects and the ones who will want to work with mural projects, how important and delicate it is to arrive to consensus. What needs to happen to to arrive to consensus? And that was a question I really never ponder upon until I met this group of Argentines. Okay. So this is how we all start, but even with the first layers, we would not be arriving to anything that got anything in common. So I thought, let's get el tiro, let's get the tape. With the tape, it is a skill for artists. You sort of connect one part to the other. And I thought, well, at least with that, you know, whatever. But then another moment that was fantastic was when the mothers came. Now, when the mothers come, that's something else, because the mothers are revered. So Enriqueta, Vera Haraj, and Aide Garcia Castellú came, and they look at the mural, they look what they were doing, they thought that they liked that, but then Enriqueta said, where are our children?
Born.
They're not here. Okay, they should be there. That's what Enriqueta said. And Vera Haraj, who is a wonderful woman, said, what I see is, what I see frequently, that we are all on the same page but disconnected. The big challenge of this mural and what we have in front of us is that we will find ways to connect. Wonderful wisdom coming from Vera, and this is Laura Conti, mother of Gustavo Conti, who disappeared. And I did not know this of Laura. Laura was a painter. She was an artist before the disappearance of her son. So she painted in this mural and said, this is the first time I'm painting in 40 years. What a beautiful gift. Laura painting with Francisco, the oldest participant and the youngest participant. So these are the roots that would not connect. But interestingly, there is a very central part, which we call the knot, el nudo, that does not disarticulate. And we really don't know what el nudo is. But here it is, here's the knot in the middle. It's something that is there. And this is a perfect portrait of Argentina. Pablo, you're here in the audience, you have to tell me. This is perfect. This is what we all have in Argentina today. These questions about what happened, why did it happen? And we may have different ideas about how it happened, why did it happen. Thing is, we have that knot in the middle, and we are trying to liberate that. We are trying to pull that apart. And this is what this mural talks about. It talks about the transit to this new journey. And the mothers are acknowledged, the rounds of the mothers as being the great diplomats and the wonderful, it's more than wonderful. I think the mothers and the grandmothers are unique figures in the history of Latin America because they went from being housewives to be leaders and politicians. They have done in one lifetime, three or four lives, they are truly an inspiration. So no one was in disagreement about having the mothers there. Well, very good. Then how to present the disappeared? Out of the question of Vera Haraj and Enriqueta, they didn't want to present the disappeared people facing us because we still don't know who they are. And they are encapsulated again in these close circular forms because some is known and some is unknown about them. What a beautiful strategy for artists to start looking at ways to represent the most crucial doubts that sometimes language is insufficient to address is now being exposed and dealt with through this community project. So this is what it is. Look how beautiful, even the tape. What happens with the tape, just for you to know, is at the very end you pull out the tape and the layers from underneath make the connection. So what this mural talks about is about a tree of life. There's a theme in this presentation, the tree of life in Exesma, the tree of life here, which is dead. The tree towards your extreme left is dead because that is what the military junta caused. But the roots are expanding, and then there's this question, and there's a big embrace on top, and moves into something new. Agitated waters is never easy, it's always going to be challenging, but it ends with this wonderful recognition for the mothers and the grandmothers. And some of the artists were doing something else, but this was a project that connected 45 artists, only few are here. Now that's a wonderful success. And it is large, and it is finished, and it is by consensus. And I did say at the christening, listen up kids, this was the most difficult mural I ever facilitated. I think we should paint another one next year, and you should start exercising consensus about a month before I get here. To be seen. Now, the big, wonderful project that makes this community a large, ongoing, collaborative project. So last year, as you may remember, we were invited to work on a project with unaccompanied minors from Central America that are currently incarcerated in a juvenile center. I think that that project was hugely successful for many reasons, highlighting, of course, the fact that the mural is beautiful and very telling and very moving. And another part of this success is that we were able to do a second project in the same place, but this time with an extra challenge, which was to take some of the participants out of the juvenile center, and we brought them here at Mary Baldwin. Like any of the projects that we have created here, as the introducer said, since I am here, there are always collaborations, wonderful collaborations between Mary Baldwin faculty and students, the School of Art in Perkin, and then some other agency that receives us, whether this juvenile center or the bakery in Stanton. What is working here at Mary Baldwin, and I cannot thank enough to my dear colleagues and friends, Mary Clay and Steve Grandy, Marlena Hobson-Darling, and everyone else who is part of this, is that before I come here in May and before the Chicas come here in May, they have to work a lot in trying to make this possible. No one can work in the community by using the aesthetics of hit and run. You know, I teach art in community at the school where I teach at CCA, and I always introduce the students by saying, art in community is the opposite of the hit and run mentality. If you are going to work in a community, that is a commitment. And you can only do it if you love it, because you know what? You're gonna be eternally overworked and underpaid. So you will do it only because you love it. So you create a commitment. And I very much think that this is a commitment that we have created among all of us here at Mary Baldwin. And we are now creating a commitment with our dear friends from the Juvenile Center, that many of the people that work with us are here tonight. So this project is very encompassing because we have students from Mary Baldwin from many different fields. Then we have the students that come with Alonso, who are the film crew. And then we have the students from social work. The alliance with social work is a new alliance. The first time we worked together with Mary Clay and social work students was last year. We are finding that it is a wonderful marriage, right? So we will continue. So please acknowledge that this project can only happen because there is a consortium of people coming together. I cannot emphasize enough how important this is. Second very important part of this project, and any, but especially in this project, was when we talk to the wonderful students from Mary Bowen and we tell them they're about to create an art project in which their ego needs to be not included. Now that concept together with art making clashes. You know, usually an artist likes to say, this is my work and my painting, or whatever your thing is. Well, here it's not going to work that way. The Mary Bowen artists are about to become artist assistants. The artists are the young people coming from the juvenile center. This is their mural, and you are about to help execute their ideas. In the real world of art of today, that is called post studio. Okay, you take it. None of the projects that we have ever done since I am here could have been done without Paulino. So my acknowledgement to Paul Borseleka, once again surprising us with a fabulous structure. I have a sort of inside story to tell you, not about this, but about working in Friedburg with the Chicas in Switzerland. We were working with political refugees, mostly from Afghanistan. This was last year, no, the year previous. And we didn't have Paulino, so we only have tape. Okay, and I knew tape was not going to do it, but okay, we tried. The whole mural came on top of us, so the four of us at the same time screamed, Paulino! And no one knew what that meant, but we knew. We really knew. And Paulino, we did miss you. So, take a look at the mural, but take a look at the structure. Fantastic. And you know where it is, not for the ones who are familiar with Mayor Bowen, this is the area of the dining area? Cafeteria. Okay, in between the two parts. So how this was going to work is we were going to be able to bring some of the participants from the juvenile center. The Mary Bowen students were going to be the assistants. And then I was allowed to go in, and also with Christina, who works there. Christina later will say hello. But we were in this alliance of having drawings, sketches done inside the juvenile center, and bring the sketches outside, and everyone in this side of the creation of the mural was going to give priority to the ideas and the drawings coming from the center, from the shelter, not the other way around. Again, I cannot emphasize how much admiration I have for all of you artists from Mary Bowen and the ones who were not even art students, but who were part of this process. It's hard to do to be the creator of something that is not your own. And especially when you are so young, you know, you don't have experience in doing this. So for that very reason, more of my appreciation and my admiration. It's very difficult to do what you were able to do. But they did it splendidly. So how this works is, like always, like you saw in Argentina, and you saw in other parts of the world, we first sit down and have ideas being drawn. And we ask the question, what is this mural going to say? What do you want to say in this mural? Who is the audience? What is the story you would like to tell? And you know, we start working, a lot of Spanish speakers, a lot of Spanish understanding and not speaking, a lot of Spanish not understanding, but understanding in another way. It was very beautiful. And it took quite a long time to come to ideas. We had a lot more ideas that it appeared to be we could fit, although the mural is large. So these are some of the drawings that were coming from the shelter. They were drawings that were telling a terrible story, a story that now is quite public because we read in the newspaper about the unaccompanied minors. We learn about narcotraffickers. traffic, we learn about what happens in the Mexico-US border. But in my perception, seeing these drawings were the most genuine way to understand what these young people go through and what are the reasons that bring them here in the first place. Conversations, many conversations, and we continue to work in the creation of the mural because there were many more participants in the shelter than last year. We decided that the border, usually the border has a decorative reason to exist. When a mural is very large, the border is a way in which visually the whole mural runs from one area to the other. But in this case, the border was going to be encapsulated in personal history. So the border was going to be broader in terms of size, and it was going to be large enough to tell stories. A lot of conversation. Very early, a tree of life appeared. And when they talk inside and outside, it appeared to be that the tree of life was that which they wanted to have as the central part of the mural. So it was gravitating towards the very center. Here's how we work, always, you know, working in different parts of the mural, paying attention to how the images are growing, moving from one direction to the other. Mary Clay and Marlena, very, very intense until they realized that, yeah, they made it. What a great picture. I love that. Very, very committed. They were totally into it. And our dear friends from Nelson County, Amy and Leslie Darling, they are very committed collaborators. We have had their collaboration for many murals, and Pablo also. So these are not Mary Baldwin affiliated people, but they are Marlena affiliated people that through extension we become affiliated with. So that's a great celebration. The more the better. So thank you, Leslie, Amy, Pablo, and the chicas. Here are the chicas. Dina, Berenice, and Rosita del Carmen, who since I arrived yesterday, they keep on telling me, and saludos to, regards to, I suspect that I know, they know that I'm saying saludos to everyone, but it's their way to be here constantly. They remember someone else they didn't remember 2 hours before, so they said, please tell such and such with me. So my most dear regards to all of you from Dina, Berenice, and Rosita del Carmen. Here, wonderful collaborators from the shelter that came and painted with us and contributed. So, what does the mural tell? The mural tells, and this is a moment I need to acknowledge also Taisira Blake. Is Taisira here? Yeah, Taisira, thank you. Taisira, wonderful collaborator to this project and others, and she's also the one who designed the poster. That's beautiful, thank you, Taisira. So Taisira calls the Tree of Life a crossing of a fracture border. What is the mural telling? The mural starts from left to right, telling the story of the crossing. And tells the story of the crossing first by water, that is unsafe. Many people make it, many more do not. And they, the ones who make it, are in this part of the border. The mural expands to the right and very rapidly presents a visual statement of violence. This is the violence they saw or they heard about This is the violence that the Argentine Forensic Anthropology team finds at the border. There's a group of the Argentine Forensic team that has been working at the Mexico-US border for about 5 years, and this is what they find. And most importantly, it's also what they do not find, because the pieces of people are scattered everywhere. This is what this is. But this is the information we are getting from this mural. There are body parts that are being cut in pieces and thrown into an acid tank. There is a moment of violence that occurs right behind the scene of the amputated part, and there's someone running away. The ones who ran away, the ones who may be the ones who escaped narco-traffic, are escaping, first of all, a situation in their countries, that's why they're crossing, and then they connect to narco-traffic voluntarily, sometimes, probably many times, by force, and some escape, and some make it to the side of the border. They also talk about the crossroads. What happens with decisions? Decisions that are difficult to take, some were bad decisions. Some are better decisions. Some is a freedom they seem not to have. Some may be coming into this country as someone who may be able to cross with papers. How to get those papers, how to become a citizen, how to become part of the system. The crossroads that the youth are confronted with is multi-layered, and some of these layers are the ones that we are looking at. For me, this part is hugely potent because it tells me in a very brief portion visually. It's telling me about the catastrophic reality that they face, which is, at this point, it's not safe in their countries, it's not safe to cross, it's not safe to be at the border itself, and if by any chance they are making it, it will not be easy to stay here. What is left for them? Right below, there is a scene of a person who has died. That is a personal story of a young man, age 16, from Honduras, that the day his father was killed, he left Honduras, in part because of fear, in part because of sadness. Mary Bowen is represented here, but as a moment of defiance of what Mary Bowen presents to all of us as an option is contraposed with an image of a young woman from Guatemala, age 14, inside the shelter. She painted herself inside the shelter with a camera, and she is crying. When we finished this mural, we took it inside the shelter, and I told her, I will show this mural many times, and every time I will say, this part was created by a Guatemalan artist. So I want you to know that, she's in the shelter, but she was able to tell her story as an artist. The tree of life is glorious, and it has one hand that is very hurt, on one side, to the left. And there is the same heart, the same hand that is flowering on the other side. A torogoz, which is a bird from El Salvador, but it acquires almost the characteristics of a mythical bird, comes into this beautiful tree. There's someone underneath the tree that is thinking about options, I suppose. In the meantime, as you can see at the top and at the bottom, what we call the border, are scenes that the participants wanted to address. Some are of violence, some are of hope, some are about art, some about love, some about options. I have said this in presentations like today, but I continue to say each of these murals could be a fantastic subject matter for a PhD dissertation, for all the layers that are involving what the visual represents. The visual is only, if you wish, it's almost like the very top of the iceberg. When you get into what the images mean, it's evocative to history, geography, politics, national, internationally, etc. Here we have a mural within a mural. The mural always starts with colors, and here the Mary Bowen artist created a mural being born, as many that we have created together. This fantastic dual image was painted by an artist who is half Salvadorian, half Nicaraguan, half from here. And in this doubt of where I am from, she finds the question of what and who I am really. And if I understand correctly, this duality made it possible to also understand the duality of some of the artists, the young artists from the shelter. This is a wonderful scene of compassion and empathy. Is we are learning from them to look at our own reality. And because we can learn about our own reality, we can see their situation a little better. It's almost a play with mirrors, I think. The next part of the mural was painted by an artist from Panama, who acknowledged that her family had to work very hard to save money to have her come to this country and to be a beholder of the US passport after all that. These two young people that are represented by being here at the shelter, they are waiting for their family somewhere in the United States. They think they are in Maryland. To my surprise, that flag is that of Maryland. Would I know that? No. Okay, but their family is from Maryland, so these are these kids waiting for the families to come. Some of the youth that are currently located at the shelter may have the possibility to reunite with their family. If it is possible to identify that there are family of theirs in the United States and the conditions are safe, they can be reunited with their family. So that's one of the many efforts that our friends from the shelter do. This wonderful image, I was almost not going to speak about it. How could I forget? This wonderful figure of the woman at the very forefront of the mural, holding a baby on a US flag. That talks about the enormous benefit of being born a US citizen. I should remind you, however, because we are close to times of elections, that in California, Proposition 187 was hostile to the concept that each person born in the United States is a citizen. Let's not hope will happen again. Nonetheless, what Proposition 187 was asking was to reconsider the right for education and health. How Proposition 187 was phrased is, children born from undocumented parents would not have right for education or health in the state of California. So you feel like you want to take all your hairs out of your head at this moment. So this is exactly what we did. We did pull the hairs out of the head, but we also did a lot of activism and marching. Pete Wilson was the governor at the time. And I'm just hoping that this bad idea does not come back. You see, politics, like I was trying to say to you about Argentina, we have to be vigilant about what is happening with politics. It's like tides. There's a moment of correctness, and then there's another one that is not of correctness at all. How that happens, Mary Hill, who's a historian, could say. I certainly don't have the answer. But I feel committed to remind ourselves to be vigilant. It was so poignant to have this image of the baby wrapped in the US flag. What a wonderful gift. The question is it really for everyone? Is this how we citizens of this country see the right to be born here or to get political asylum? What does it take to get political asylum in the United States today? And this is not only today, what we have here in the United States is a problem. Let's consider what is happening in Europe with the Syrian refugees. This is something that, you know, we are one ocean apart, but it will manifest itself in a ramification of different processes that will be part of our life. Moreover, even if it doesn't touch our life, it should. It's not a problem that Germany has. It's a much larger problem. In the world that we live, when we talk about globalization and we feel so comfortable or not about what the globalized world is, we can no longer afford thinking that the Syrian refugees is a problem of Europe. I was just reading yesterday, coming back to Mary Baldwin, I bought The Economist. There is a great article about what Brazil is trying to do. It has given 8,000 visas to the Syrian population. They are giving 2,000 political asylum, et cetera, et cetera. But it analyzes why Brazil is doing that and not other countries in Europe. Is the answer geography? No, that is not the answer. The other answer is, should be considered in the analysis, ideology. What makes a country have a vitality for open doors or close? This affects prominently the youth working in these projects. What is what will stop them? Another wall? The answer was given by an Honduran boy, age 16. This is the whole mural. In one of the drawings, the boy says, the Honduran government has the obligation of creating work possibilities for the youth. Do it for peace and do it for us. That is exactly how immigration can be reversed. And this is prominent when one considers the funding that may be placed in yet another wall. If that funding on yet another wall would be placed in El Salvador, Guatemala, Mexico, and Honduras today, creating micro sustainable enterprises that will give work to the kids that are escaping, it's very possible that this can be reverted. Basically what is happening in El Salvador, I know the other countries well, but I know El Salvador very well. In a nutshell, to comprehend what we are talking about, I would say that all economy that was at one time based on agriculture in El Salvador has been replaced for narcotraffic. The only profitable industry of El Salvador today is narcotraffic, with everything that comes attached to that, insecurity, crime, etc. So how can one change that? I think the answer is that the boy gave. The Honduran government, and we can say extensively all the countries in Central America and probably the United States, have the obligation to create work opportunities for the youth. Do it for peace and do it for us. Here's some projects here, photographs. Alonso, always there. Here we are with Christina. And this is the group getting our depiction. diplomas. One wonderful part of this project is that we get diplomas. We all get diplomas, and I don't know about you, but I frame mine. And this is how I would like to end this presentation today. This mural is dedicated to the wonderful artist. I want to tell you before you have the chance to actually see the real mural, that the mural is about to start traveling. In March of 2016, at the California College for the Arts, we are creating a symposium about narco traffic. And I have asked CCA to bring the mural, and they will bring the mural, and also Cristina to talk about it. And the Center for Latin American Studies at UC Berkeley also want the mural. And in a brief conversation I had with Professor Harley Shaken, who is the director of the Center for Latin American Studies, I said it in this way, Harley, I want you to know that I will continue to hope that the mural will come. And he said, Claudia, we are past hope. We are doing it now. So I think this is where the mural will be traveling. For sure, I would also hope to be able to show it at the Center for Justice and Accountability in San Francisco. And all this is because I think the mural that you all have created, that we all have created, is a fantastic tool for broadcasting a story that is never found on the papers. So thank you so much to all of you for having created this in collaboration and in community. Thank you. And now you will have the opportunity to actually see the mural, thanks to the muralists in the house and the world planning.
What kind of paint do you use in all of your projects?
We this sounds like I'm going to have an advertisement, but believe me, I don't get $1 off from this. I get the mural paint from a big factory in Los Angeles called Nova Color. And I would say that it's the best kind of mural paint that I know of. It's very effective for inside, but also very effective for outside. So especially when you're working with exterior mural, you need a painting that will be elastic enough. This paint is manufactured with fiberglass, which makes it so durable. Still needs a final varnish. You would think that after all these years, Nova Color would give me some discount. They don't. But they sell a lot of art materials for a lot of wonderful artists who do this kind of work too. Questions or thoughts? Yes? Yes.
How can we help?
Pardon me?
How can we help?
What a question. I love that question. How can you help? With what? With disseminating this idea? With what kind of help do you imagine that you can produce?
Habla español,
pero el resto no. Habla español, que bueno, no puede hacer de intérprete, entonces. Okay. So, how can we help? That is a wonderful question, and the question I produce back is also a good one. When one knows that wants to help, the other question may be, how? What can I do? And then is to start figuring out what are the tools that we can create for this new collaboration, meaning time available. We can always ask for hands to work in one capacity or other, or if you speak Spanish, you can be an interpreter for these projects. We can always use resources, sometimes it's funding, sometimes it's materials, sometimes it's connections. We are taking the mural now to the West Coast. We hope that the mural will travel elsewhere. Maybe you can be a partner of this project and imagine that this story will travel. And we'll tell a story, as I said at the end, that is frequently not known. So I would love to get your name and contact information, and then see how do you see from what we have created here, how can this grow? Yeah? Gracias. Yes? Question? No, I was just ahead. Okay. There is a question, okay.
Can you talk a little bit more about the timing in terms of the planning process as well as the actual planning specifically of the mural and things?
You know, it really fluctuates, and it fluctuates according to the time that the participants have. So the mural that was so difficult to paint in Argentina was actually done in 3 days, remarkably. But that should go already in one block. For these projects that we create here at Mary Baldwin, it takes the 3 weeks of May term. So sometimes I cannot come the full 3 weeks because I'm still teaching in California, but what Marlena and Mary Clay and Steve have done is that the first week before our arrival, what you do as a group is learn the history of El Salvador, the history of Central America, and there's a moment of reading and a moment of watching films, etc. So when I come, when the chicas come, we usually come from two different parts of the world at the same time, then we are ready. We know what we are working with, and we know the participants' personal history to fully comprehend how can we of help, how this is not going to be a pretty picture. This is a beautiful mural, but it's also a very potent message. But in the real world, just to answer a little further your question, I never propose the time. I always accept the time. Working in rural areas in Latin America, many times people have very short available time because they are in the circuit of planting and agriculture, so sometimes we have 4 days. We start early and we finish late. That part of the strategy of working in community is trying to understand when the community is ready. And to many, many projects born in a crisis area, it may take a long time until it happens. I was talking to, I don't know who, just today, I think to Colin, that I was ready to go to Mexico in September to work with the families of the 43 students who were kidnapped last year and disappeared in Iguala, Guerrero. They are from the rural school of Ayotzinapa. 3 days before going, they called me to tell me that that project was canceled because the conditions of safety for the participants were not granted. So we might take another full year until that happens. So, you know, to be an artist in communities, to always be very attentive to what are the conditions of the community. And in this case, like in Mexico, to be very sure that the conditions of safety are granted. Thank you.
I need to insert myself just for a second. I realize that the students,
you all want to
arms are getting tired.
While the group is putting
the mural down, I want to let you know we just found out recently that on Saturday night, Claudia will be receiving another award. Claudia's received many awards. And she doesn't do this work to receive awards. But this award that she's getting is, I think it's very noteworthy. It's from the International Peace and Justice Studies Association. And they'll be awarding Claudia the Social Courage Award. And it seems so appropriate that Claudia will receive this acknowledgement of her work because for Claudia, it's like our theme this year, Mary Ballard's moment. And for Claudia, each moment is a moment of integrity for her. And I think this award acknowledges that, that you have each moment you have an opportunity to speak with courage or to be silent. And for Claudia, whether it's about a pressing political issue or it's joy, there's always that sense of integrity. And so I'm so thrilled that the Peace and Justice Studies Association is recognizing this contribution that you've made that inspired all of us to be truthful in each moment. So thank you and congratulations.